Psalm 119, verses 65 through 32. Psalm 119, verses 65 through 72. From the New International Version, hear ye God's word for this day. Do good to your servant according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment, for I trust your commands. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. You are good, and what you do is good. Teach me your decrees. Though the arrogant has snared me with lies, I keep your precepts with all my heart. Their hearts are callous and unfeeling, but I delight in your law. It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. The law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. My sisters and brothers, this is the word of God for the people of God, and we say thanks be to God. Now I will declare to you that this is the type of message that requires big girl and big boy too. Because the key verse makes absolutely no sense in the natural. The key verse is verse 71. It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. Who in there, right? Would say it was good for me to be broken. It was good for me to go through the storm, the rain, and the fire. It was good for me to be broke, busted, and disgusted. It was good for me to be left all alone. It was good for me to be afflicted. I questioned the Lord about this message. It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. So I want to talk about the good in a bad situation. The good in a bad situation. Today's message is almost a continuation of last Sunday's message. You will remember that it was entitled, What to Do in Tough Times. And for those of you who were in our joint women and men Sunday school class this morning, you can surmise that these sermonic juices were indeed flowing this week when Sister Zena and I met to plan the lesson. I was under the impression that last Sunday's sermon was enough of a spiritual prescription for a little while to deal with the difficulties of life. But by Tuesday of the week, as I was minding my own business, the Spirit of the Lord began to speak clearly and fluidly with another dose that would be the order of the day. So here we are again dealing with the trials and tribulations of life, the bad stuff in the presence of our faith in a good God. Yes. The bad stuff in the presence of our faith in a good God. Now I think it's important and appropriate that we come to terms with the goodness of God. We've said it so often, God is good. God is the author and finisher is never greater than the grace of the teacher.
Amen.
Let me say that again. God is the teacher.
Yes,
teacher. Okay? And the good thing about this teacher is that this teacher is never absent. So this teacher never needs a substitute and never needs anybody to say amen. Remember when you were in school and the teacher left the room? So, can I take it? Please, can I take it? You didn't realize that made you a snitch. But on the street they say a snitch ends up in the ditch, y'all ain't talking. I bet y'all can figure out that I often took names. I often. Such a nerd. God is the teacher. We are the students. As such, let us remember the challenge of the assignments 4 years ago. Tell them they got to leave something. Go to Taylor, South Carolina. Will never take you, but the grace of God cannot heal you. So Pastor T, that's great. That's wonderful. I'm glad to know that God is a teacher. But why does my life sometimes feel like I fail my courses and I always end up in summer school? Well, I come today to challenge us all to come to God with the perspective of a realist. Those of you that are poor, you like that language. To be a realist. The Dennis Latham likes that language. In the finance ministry meeting. To be a realist. And that's great. And it has its place. Because 2 plus 2 equals 4. So we come to God as realists, but the attitude of a faith walk. Because we walk by faith and not by sight. Y'all ain't talking to me. Y'all still on the bus. Let me see if I can keep the bus up. The doctor says you're sick. You don't go around telling people, oh, I don't have high blood pressure. I'm not even going to take a medicine. That's ignorant. That's not wisdom, and don't blame that on God. Why are you claiming your healing and taking medicine? Take your medicine. If you don't take your medicine, we're going to be saying, yeah.
Yes, sir.
first. Life often doesn't make sense. Life tends to interrupt progress. Life happens without schedule. But it's up to you how you respond to life. Some of us walking time bombs. Can't say nothing. That doesn't mean we miss the opportunity to speak in the language of our faith, to live in the mindset of our faith. That leads to our hope and our optimal spiritual health. The Bible says that God desires that we would prosper and be in good health. Everybody want to win the lottery? That's wonderful. Amen. I don't play it, and I want to win it. That's crazy. Well, what good is winning the lottery if you're in your right mind? If you're not in your right mind, the crazy cousin John, who y'all let come to Thanksgiving dinner every other year. Because you don't take your medicine. John will steal your ticket. And John will walk around saying, I'm blessed and I am. The perspective of the Psalms. Psalm 119 is the longest psalm in the Bible. It's the longest. You need 119 days to read it. It's long. But it's divided into sections. And so in one of the sections, verses 65 through 72, the psalmist who we believe to be David, king of Israel, man after God's own heart, the one who had a liver problem, but God still had favor with life. The psalmist asked the Lord to do good to him. But he didn't say, do good to me according to my wishes. But he says, do good to me according to your word, Lord. Teach me knowledge and good judgment. That's a request for wisdom. For I trust your commands. So Lord, I trust what you tell me. Now, before I was afflicted, and y'all know people like this, who God got their attention through trials and tribulations. 99.9% of us who say we've given our life to Christ, we have some stuff assist who goes at home. You got turned down by family, your friends acted like they didn't know you. Where shall I go but to the Lord? I needed a refuge for my soul. And when I needed a friend who would save me at the end, where shall I go but to the Lord? He didn't say before I was afflicted, I went astray. Before anything was wrong, I was right not what I wanted to be. But after my affliction, that thing saved my life. Whatever your affliction was, it doesn't have to be physical. It can be emotional, mental, financial, relational, whatever it was that stopped you, stopped me, stopped whoever in their tracks. That was the affliction that saved our life. And the psalmist goes on to say, Lord, you are good. What you do is good. Remember, I told you that God is good when?
All the time.
You are good. What you do is good. You teach me your decrees that are good. And even though there's some who are arrogant, they ain't never had no trouble in their life. sin. They got more trunk than trunk. But Lord, even in the midst of callous and unfeeling hearts, I choose to delight in your law. So the world can do whatever it wants to do, but Lord, I will follow you. That's what he's saying. Because in every bad situation, my sisters and brothers, there is some good. It was good, verse 71. It was good for me to be afflicted, so that I might learn your decrees. I said it takes big boy and big girl fools today to declare, to testify. It was good for me to be afflicted. It was good for me to go through some hard times. It was good for me to have some issues and situations. It was good for the Lord to have to bring me to a place where God can use me. It was good that everything I planned did not go as planned. It was good because my affliction saved my life. It was good for me. I mean, you got to be walking with Jesus to be able to say it was good for me. It was good for my heart to have been broken. Lord, help me, Jesus. It was good for me to have been betrayed. It was good for me to have been denied. It was good for me to have been dismissed. It was good for that church in Darlington said in 1999, we don't want no woman. Praise Jesus! Because God had a better plan for this woman. And I'm glad about it. And it's shame God that had a plan for me. He had a plan for you. But you have to report for duty. So many people stand on the premises, who stand on the promises. And the Lord has done anything for you. You ought to let the world know he brought some good to my bad situation. Honey, somebody say, neighbor, it was good that I was broke. I had bought enough liquor. I had bought enough drugs. I had bought enough sex. I had bought enough things that I didn't need. Yeah. We talked. Y'all sit down and finish. We talked this morning. It was good for me to cry.
Yes.
Because I learned Psalm 35.
Yes.
Weeping.
Yes.
Being doomed.
Yes.
For a night.
Yes.
But joy comes.
Yes.
In the morning.
Yes.
And when you get the joy of Jesus, honey, ain't nobody can do nothing with you. Ain't nobody can do nothing with you. When you got the joy of Jesus. Story. And the person who gets sick along the journey, whether it's drugs, alcohol, whatever the limit is, whatever the condition is, we all have a condition. But in our situation, my brother, the oldest, he went through his stuff as a young child, a teenager, 16. Because of his challenges, I became the oldest. The middle child became the oldest. And because he still struggles with that inferiority, he has resentment. He tells the whole world, my sister, y'all gotta be rich. Didn't work out.
Your plan B didn't work out. Your plan C didn't work out. Your plan D was dumb from the start. There's good in a bad situation.
Yeah. Yeah.